This video will serve as an introduction to Chapter 11.1, called Function Basics. To begin talking about functions, and before we even define them formally, I want to recall something that you may be familiar with from past math classes, which is the idea of inputs and outputs. This has been an idea that has been around since we have been, you know, started playing with variables in past math classes, and typically we have used the variable x most of the time to denote the input and the variable y to denote the output. So for example, if you have an equation like y equals 3x minus 1, which you would identify as a linear equation, you could evaluate it, meaning plug in values of x, different numbers, and record their outputs, and you might record your values in a table, for instance. Oops, let's just get a straight line here. Something like this for a table for this equation. And I'll just make it real quick. If x is negative 2, plug that in there, you get y equals 3 times negative 2 minus 1, which is negative 7. If x is negative 1, you get y equals 3 times negative 1 minus 1, which is negative 4, and so forth. And we can see a pattern here. I think it's minus 1, 2, and 5. So this column, are inputs. They're x values, as usual. And these are the y values, but not just any y values. Each y value is tied to the x value it came from. It is the output to a specific input. And this is not a new idea. What we do in this section is generalize this idea and give it its true name, which is, this is what's called a function. Let me write the definition down and then I'll pause. A function, and this is not an overly formal definition, but for now, just think of a function as a process. Some people call it, you know, a rule or a machine, but I'll just say a process that turns each input, or sends, let me replace that with sends, and here's the key part, to exactly only one output. And another thing you might add here is that consistently sends. What does that mean? Well, let's, before we go any further, look back at our linear equation, which takes inputs x and gives outputs y, makes the table, points on the graph. The idea of sending consistently each input to one output is saying that if you choose a number to go in for your x, like for instance we chose negative 1, multiplied it by 3, took away 1 from that, and got negative 4. We got one in value, one y value only, and if I, you know, were to test the x value of negative 1 in numerous times in that equation, I would always get the same output. And that's never going to change, because if I multiply negative 1 by 3 and then take away 1 from it, it's not going to come out differently no matter how many times I do it. So that's what's meant by saying these functions are consistent, and not only are they consistent, but I got the same y value. I didn't get different y values at different, you know, more than one y value. I only got one. And that will always be the case. So let me do another example. While we're still drawing the connection between this new idea of a function and equations that we've seen in the past, before we introduce any notation, here's another equation. This time, y equals x squared, because you have the power of 2, this is a quadratic equation, and the graph would be a parabola. But it's worth just playing out what this looks like if you want to plot points or evaluate it or make a table. So as before, let's just throw in a table with some central x values, just chosen for, you know, convenience, and ask, well, what is this? If this is a function as we're describing, that should mean that it, for any x that goes in there, it sends it consistently to an output. And what does it do to it? What is its process? It's taking the inputs and it's squaring them, and whatever the square of the x is, we call that y, the output. So let's see. If we put in negative 2 for the first row in the table, we have negative 2 squared is 4. So the output there is 4. And then what's next? Negative 1 squared is positive 1. So that. And from there, we can generate this table pretty quickly. 0 squared is 0. Positive 1 squared is 1. And positive 2 squared is 4. And again, these are just 5 x values that I chose out of all the ones I could have chosen, but just enough to get a picture. And just to look at this table once again with this new idea of a function, what's important here is that every x value was sent to one and only one y value. And if I test any of these x values, you know, through the function, no matter how many times I do it, it should always go to that same thing. In other words, this negative 2 will always go to 4. Why is that true? Because it's always the case that negative 2 times itself is 4. It can't be anything else because that's what the numbers say. And the same goes true for any input. If you square an input, what it comes out to be is always going to be that number. But what's different about this table that I want to comment on before we go on is, compared to the table for the linear one, is that here we have y values that seem to appear in different places, the same y values. We have 4s in a couple places, 1s in a couple places. And I want to just mention that this is not a flaw in the idea of a function. It's not actually breaking any rules. Nothing in a function says you can't get the same output from different inputs. Notice that where did that 4 and 4 come from? They came from two different inputs. They just so happened to go to the same output because negative 2 squared is 4, but positive 2 squared is also 4. So same output there from two different inputs. The reason this is okay is that a function, to be a function, and again we're talking about definition here, just has to take each distinct input and send it to exactly one place consistently. And that has happened here. The negative 2 went one place only. The positive 2 went one place only. It does not violate anything from a function perspective for two distinct inputs to happen to be sent to the same output. That's okay. And we'll discuss that a lot more in class. So let me just talk now about how we can represent functions. Again, this idea of a function is saying for each input, in whatever it is, you are sending it or assigning it to one output in particular. And there are really 4 ways to look at functions, and they are like this. You could write it there. See them as a description, or in other words, written verbally or with language. You can see them the way we have been seeing them, which is as an equation or a formula. Most common way most people see functions. You can also represent functions as tables, which we'll practice in class. And you can also represent a function by its graph, a kind of visual depiction of the function. So let me scroll up a bit. Here was an equation or a formula. Here was another equation or formula. What's interesting is, I'll just make up a quick table. And again, keep it very simple. X and Y standing for input output. I could make a table. It'd be a little strange, but I could make a table without an equation. I could just kind of make it up as long as I'm careful. Suppose that if X is 1, Y is 3. And if X is 2, Y is 7. I'm just making this up. And if X is 3, Y is 0. And 4, Y is 2. And 5y is negative 9. Now there seems to be no kind of rhyme or reason to these outputs, And there's certainly no equation that I can think of that would give me all these together. But the important thing is that if you take this column as just, five different inputs, and this column as the output that goes with each, then this table also describes some function because it's simply saying each input got sent to one output. And that's all you really need to be a function. We'll talk about this idea a good deal more in class. So the only other thing I want to cover in this video is a brief introduction to what's called function notation and why we would use it. To return for a moment to the linear equation we had before, we called it y equals 3x minus 1. And now I'm claiming that this is, in fact, a function, not just an equation. It took in its inputs x and it gave the output y. So the only difference is, and we'll talk more about why we do this in class, a function may have a name like f. I'll call it, say that's the name of a function, of this function. How does this change how we write it? Well, rather than saying y equals f of x, we say, sorry, rather than saying y equals 3x minus 1, we say 3x minus 1 is equal to, write it like this, and you pronounce that as f of x. Now here's a very important thing. This is still our output. That y was the output. We just are calling the output f of x instead of y. And what that's saying is that we take some input x, run it through a function, and it gives a corresponding output. And we will, it's, I'll spend time in class talking about the real value of this, but for now I just want to give one more example of how to do what we did before in this new notation, function notation. Suppose I wanted to build this table from scratch. And I have my function f of x is equal to 3x minus 1. To build a table means to put in inputs and evaluate them, right? So for instance, what if x was to be 1? That means I put it into the input and I write it like so, f of 1. This is saying, given the input 1 into function x, what's the output? The cool thing about this is whatever you replace your input with there, it gets mirrored over here. This is familiar if you're recalling how evaluation works. This is just a new notation for it. I replace my x with the specific number, and on the right side, I do the math. 3 times 1 is 3, and then take away 1 is 2. So here's the real payoff to this. F of 1, strange to say, but that's how we would say it, f of the value 1 is 2. And this is one of the nice things about function notation is previously, this would have been a entry on the table, 1, 2, but we would have needed a table to write that. Now, with this function notation, which was previously, a y, we can sort of see on the surface that the input of 1 goes in and gets an output of 2. So function notation makes a little bit more explicit the relationship between input and output without needing a table. And that's something we'll spend a good deal more time practicing in class. So just to wrap this up, what is a function? Always go back to this. A function is just some rule or process defined by an equation or a graph or a table or verbally that takes each input and sends it to one and exactly one output. In a future video, we'll discuss when that breaks down. And function notation sort of rewrites the XY equations that you may be used to and replaces the Y with this F of X, meaning the output value for some specific X under the function F.